I'm grateful to the organizers for the invitation, and I would like to start with to comment that when we first negotiated about the title of this presentation, we were not pretty sure whether better to keep it a more general kind of presentation on this flexibility or better to focus on one certain example. And after we have had this perfect setting of the scene by Professor Applegate, I think it was a good idea, Pierre-André, to focus on one example, and this example is phytate, and this phytate is a perfect example that we can look at because the bird has developed fantastic mechanisms to adjust to phytate supply to the intestine on one hand, and on the other hand, many things that we do when we design our diets affect this potential of the bird to deal with it, especially the mineral supply. So that is the reason why we focus on that. So everybody in the room probably knows what we talk about here, phytic acid, abbreviated in my presentation as INSPY6. Main storage form of phosphate in all our cereal grains and all the not only cereal grains, also other seeds and all the byproducts that are produced from it, with this inositol ring system here and the 6 phosphate groups attached to it very often, and depending on the pH, together with cations bound to the negatively charged phosphate groups. And what we can read when we look to the textbooks and what official committees, well-known committees all over the world say, is that phytate, phosphorus, is poorly digested. Very often people say it is phytate, phosphorus cannot be utilized at all by the bird. And I'm afraid that for all of you who until this moment still believe that this is correct, I have to say it is not. It is a misconception. The bird is able to utilize phytate to a large extent, at least under certain conditions. And I mean, imagine for a moment you would be a bird. And for hundreds, thousands of years, you developed in an evolutionary process, liking to pick seeds with all this phytate, and at the same time need phosphorus for your growth. Wouldn't it be a good idea to develop mechanisms to get some phosphate out of this phytate because you don't have access to alternative phosphorus sources? And this is where the intestine comes into play. And this is a very, compared to what we have seen before, a very simplistic view of the of a section of the intestine with a muscle layer here and the epithelial cells with the villi on top of it, secreting mucus and some other stuff, as we have heard before, in the mucosal layer here, and of course responsible for all these enzymes that are produced by the mucosa, released into the mucosal layer. And we have the content of the digestive tract that consists of all the so far undigested nutrients and substrates. And what you also see indicated here with these different symbols are representative of the microbiota composition. And what you can see is that the colors that are used for these different microbial groups are different. And that should indicate that the microbiota composition is to a large extent different within this mucosal layer from that what we find in the lumen of the digestive tract. And this is important because this is related to the enzymes that are produced by specific microbial groups. And very often only the digester fractions in the microbiota in the digester fraction is analyzed, although we have good reasons to assume that this composition here in the mucosal layer is much more important. So just to show you this with one example, forget about all the details that are shown here. This is from a collaboration that we had with Dr. Camarena Silva's group in our institute, where we used 8 different diets. They differed in phosphorus, calcium, and phytase concentration. As I said, forget about all the details. These are samples taken from the ileum of broilers, and on the left-hand side, you have the relative abundance of several microbial groups in the digester, and on the right-hand side in the mucosa fractions. And just have a view on the different color pattern on the left-hand side and on the left and on the right-hand side, and that clearly shows you how different the composition of the microbiota in these two sections is. So, but getting back to our picture here of the intestine. So what now happens is that this is exposed to phytate. We have our substrate arriving here and moving through the digestive tract. This apparently is a bird with a relative high passage rate. And you can see that this gets in contact, of course, with the mucosal layer. And what then happens is that the epithelium reacts, and Dr. Applegate already showed you about some of these adaptation processes. This also takes place when we have phytate present here in the digestive tract in regard to mucine secretion. And I just want to show you this one example here. There are some other examples around, but I like this a lot. This is from the work of Dr. Adeola's lab, where they used fastened birds. They tube fed them a dextrose solution, and this dextrose solution contained either free phytic acid or a magnesium potassium phytate. And that was contained in this solution, and they administered that and then collected total excreta for a period of 54 days and measured a lot of things. And just to show here the total excretion of crude mucine for these birds, you can clearly see how this mucine excretion increase, particularly in the case of phytate administration. And of course, this is related to endogenous losses of amino acids and other things. So we have to keep in mind that this is a fairly artificial situation with this starved bird and only dextrose, and so the real world probably will be different from that. But anyhow, it shows how the principles work and how what the principle mechanisms of adaptation are. So, but this is not the only thing that the only way the birds react. Getting a bit closer to the situation of digestibility and digestibility studies, and to diets based on corn, soy. What we often do is, when we are interested in the relevance for the digestive processes, we look what happens until the end of the ileum is reached. We call that prececal digestibility. The section that we sample in these studies is shown here. This is what often also is called ileal digestibility. So, and in several studies we have seen now, when feeding these corn soybean meal based diets without a phytase supplement and measure what proportion of phytate is degraded until the end of the ileum. And remember what I started with, completely unavailable. Here you can see that it is in the range of 70% degraded. 70% of phytate is no longer present at the end of the ileum. And this is important to know, that this is for the situation of a low phosphorus supply, so these diets didn't contain any inorganic phosphorus and had a low calcium level, meaning the bird was challenged to make most out of what is contained in the plant material. So, when we talk a little bit more about the details of phytate degradation, it might be worth to remember what different enzymes we have involved in this initial phytate degradation process. So you probably are aware of this differentiation. When we have a phytase starting on the sixth position with the cleavage of phosphate, then we call it a 6-phytase. We usually have that in the bacteria. When we have the 3 position here as the initial position of attack, then it's a 3-phytase, and in plant materials we often have phytases that start on the 4 position, and we call them 4-phytases. And in our work, we, by differentiating these different positional isomers of the pentaphosphates, we try to better understand from which sources these phytases that are involved in the degradation process come from. So principally, we have these different origins of enzymes that are involved in this process. So we have, of course, a possibility that some plant material contains intrinsic phytase activity. We have the endogenous phytase sources, which we will focus on today, which can be separated into mucosal phytases and other phosphatases, and into those who are produced by the microbes that are present in the digestive tract. And of course, we also have added exogenous phytases, as we all know, but this will not be in the focus of this presentation. So if we just have one short view on these on the relevance of plant intrinsic phytases, I would like to show you the results of the doctoral project of Ellen Seller, one of my PhD students. She used wheat-based diets in this case, and wheat in the one situation remained untreated. So, I mean, it was ground, but it was not otherwise specifically treated. So original phytase activity maintained, and in a different treatment, this wheat was microwave treated with the goal to reduce phytase activity. It is not possible to completely remove phytase activity with this kind of treatments, but you can see that the phytase activity was drastically reduced. And then samples from different sections of the digestive tract of broilers were taken, and phytate disappearance, or phytate breakdown, measured. And you can see already in the crop, in the situation of wheat phytase present, the phytate breakdown is very high. And as expected, if the phytase is inactivated, largely inactivated, then this is much lower. But already when you arrive in the duodenum jejunum, we couldn't separate these sections in sampling, took it together, but already when you arrive here, this difference has totally disappeared. And when you come to the end of the ileum, then it is even slightly overcompensated, probably because this microwave treatment also changed other things to the wheat, not only the phytase activity. But what can clearly be concluded from these results, and we have seen that in similar way in other studies as well, is that yes, we do have the situation that intrinsic plant phytase is active in birds, primarily in the crop, but if it is not there, it doesn't make much of a difference, because apparently other enzymes then take over this function in phytate breakdown. And these enzymes can only come from the mucosa of the birds or from the microbes that are in the digestive tract. So this brings us to the next part of the story, and that is phytase activity in the mucosa of broilers. And several results were published in recent years. This is just one example from a collaboration with Professor Huber. She is a physiologist in our institute. And these are data from an experiment where, from a broiler study, where we combined two levels of MCP supply, the diet without any MCP supplementation, and the gray ones had an MCP supplementation. That was one factor, and the second factor was phytase supplementation. You can see here that for certain reasons that don't need to be explained now, we included here an extremely high level of phytase supplementation in this study. So, and what is important here is that phytase activity in brush border membrane vesicles was studied, and you can see that there was substantial activity in these intestinal tissues. It was not so clearly affected in this study by the different combinations of phosphorus and phytase, but there was a tendency towards a significant decrease in the situation when the combination of high phytase and MCP supplied, that's my interpretation, so much phosphate in the digestive tract that the bird was no longer challenged to produce own phytase. So this is principally known. Unfortunately, we so far don't have any idea what this means in a more quantitative sense. So we don't know how much phytate can be degraded by these mucosal enzymes. So, and the second possibility is that phytase was contributed by the intestinal microbiota. So these are data from the same animal experiment, looking into microbiota composition. And I have to admit that at this stage, we still only looked at the microbiota composition in the digester, not in the mucosal layer. So we learned in recent years, and I only picked those results from all these data that showed significant treatment effects, and that was for the MCP supplementation in the crop and for the phytase supplementation in the ilium. And this is a focus on four lactobacilli species here, and you can see that there were significant reductions in certain lactobacilli species here upon MCP supplementation and also on phytase supplementation in the ilium. Now, this is nothing about function, this is only about relative abundance, but the interesting point at this stage was that we saw that some of these lactobacilli and some of the strains of these Crispatus, for example, they were described in literature as phytase producers. So we cannot say anything about causal relationships from these results, but at least it makes sense to assume that when you supply more phosphate by either phytase or by MCP, then the microbiota system is less triggered to favor those microorganisms who produce phytase. Again, unfortunately, we don't have any information about the quantitative relevance of this microbiota contribution to phytate breakdown. And last example, or last part of the picture in this regard, this is from the collaboration that we did with Professor Seifert's group in our institute. She's her group, they are the specialists in proteomics, and they always look at the microbiota coming from the function, so from the proteins that are produced. This is from cecal samples from the same experiment, so unfortunately we couldn't do that in the ilium. And again, I don't want to go into any details here. I believe that one of the disadvantages of all this fantastic microbiota research is that the results from microbiota studies are so difficult to present, at least in oral presentations. So that's why I decided to better maintain be a nutritionist. But anyway, if you have low phosphorus here in this treatment, then this evaluation shows that again. I'm sorry, you can't see that, but you will have it in the backup material. That again, by function, not by phylogeny, by function, this lactobacilli are triggered. And interestingly, the calculation showed that. Under these P limitation conditions, all this bulk of proteins that is produced there gives an indication, or is considered by microbiologists as an indicator of a stressed microbiome, stressed by phosphorus deficiency in this regard. So, now the interesting question is, can we differentiate between what the contribution of the epithelial enzymes is and the microbes, and that is very difficult to distinguish. In a collaboration with the colleagues from the University of Saskatchewan, we tried that in using a gnotobiotic chicken model, and if you are interested in that, I will not tell you any details about the results today, but you can hear all about it in nutrition session 3. I think it's on Wednesday afternoon. I assume that many of you will attend EPC. So, getting back to our picture here, and phytate is not the only stuff that moves along. We have this combination with all these other constituents of the diet, and we now get phosphorus and calcium into it. So phytate doesn't move alone. It is, it looks a bit like hunted by calcium and phosphorus, and it is perhaps a little bit like that. So calcium is well known to affect solubility of phytate and so on, and we have direct phosphorus effect on phytate breakdown. And that is what I would like to show you now. This is from, I haven't mentioned before, but I really want to mention that I consider myself a very privileged person because I've always had very dynamic, very very dedicated and bright young people working with me who did all these experiments as part of their PhD studies. So I took results from 4 of the previous experiments where we used different levels of phosphorus and calcium supply upon a corn soybean meal based diet. You see the level of phosphorus supplementation here, and you can see how this affected the INSPY6 breakdown in the digestive tract. This is a mix of effects from both phosphorus and calcium. What you can see is, there is of course a high variation between different studies, we know that, but if you are a little bit brave and calculate linear regressions, then you can see that roughly phytate phosphorus release from is reduced by 0.5 if you give 1 gram of inorganic phosphorus. So you destroy basically the potential of the bird by adding phosphate. What you admittedly need to do to cover the requirement at least of the young bird. But this probably is one of the reasons why these old textbooks say, well, we don't have any phytate breakdown or nothing important about phytate breakdown, because that was all done using studies or evaluating studies that had a lot of inorganic phosphorus and calcium contained in their diets. So, and this is another more detailed picture on the situation here. So, phytate breakdown until the end of the ileum and under the condition of no MCP supplementation, the light bars here, and MCP supplementation, again you can see a clear reduction in phytate breakdown with phosphate supplementation, and here's the combination with the phytase supplementation, so as expected, the phytase supplementation increased phytate breakdown in both conditions here, but the difference between the non-MCP and MCP supplemented treatment still remains here, only in the situation that you do have a very high level of phytase supplementation, you are in the situation that you can overcompensate all these interactions. And this is, in my opinion, a very interesting story for all of you who deal with this under practical conditions, because it clearly shows how important it is to find the right balance for each individual situation that you have out there in the field in regard to phosphorus level in the diet, phytate level in the diet, calcium level in the diet, and phytase supplementation. The worst thing that you can do to your bird is trying to reduce phosphorus a little bit in order to reduce cost and to do something good for the environment and for resource management, and at the same situation not reduce calcium. The worst thing that you can do is using excess calcium supplementation in your diets, and what people often tell me is that is still is the case out there in the field, which is not good. So, getting a bit closer to the end now, we have this situation here again about our phytate molecule here, and the vision is, what is the vision? The vision is that we have all six phosphate groups released from the ring system, well, this is partially achieved, but not in general, and I will show you that INSPY6 disappearance, which is what we talked about so far, does not mean that all six phosphate groups are released and absorbed by the bird. We can assume that everything that is released from the ring system can be absorbed. We know that from several experiments, but we can't assume that everything is released here. And this is from a more recent study of Vera Sommerfeld in our institute, and here we have a combination of different in the diets. We had a combination of different supplements of phosphorus and calcium. This is the treatment without phosphate supplementation and only mild calcium supplementation. Then this is only calcium supplemented, this is only phosphorus supplemented, and the last one is supplemented both to what we assume is adequate level. And what you can see here is now we talk about concentrations. This is the concentrations of all inositol phosphates that were found at the end of the ileum. And as seen before, there is a clear effect of calcium and phosphorus supplementation on phytate breakdown, showing that when you add the minerals, then you have more phytate still present at the end of the ileum. The worst situation is the one where phytates and where phosphorus and calcium are supplemented together. Now, the interesting point is that when we look in all the degradation products, so when we differentiate this sum here into the individual inositol phosphates, then yes, we do have a quite high proportion of INSPY6 left there. So there is some phytate that remains inaccessible to the enzymes. But as you can see here, you have all intermediate steps, including INSPY1 and INSPY2. You have all these intermediate products still there. So you cannot assume that everything that is no longer detected as INSPY6 is automatically completely degraded. You can assume that roughly 80% of INSPY6 that you measure as degraded really leads to the corresponding phosphorus release. And to the end, of course, the last question is, what about inositol, the second end product of this degradation process? I'm sorry about the coloring here. It's a bit different on my screen, but I think you can see that here again we have some lighter bars and some darker bars, and this is here the combination of calcium and phosphorus supplementations again to the corn soybean meal based diet. And when you have the situation here of low supply, then you can see a concentration of approximately 10 micromoles of inositol in ileal digester, and this concentration is sharply reduced upon supplementation. So again, showing that these phosphorus and calcium supplements affect the whole degradation process. But it also shows that some of the phytate can be completely degraded. Some can be completely degraded, and it's part of the theory that this inositol that is additionally released has a phosphate independent effect on the metabolism of the bird. We see very clear relationships between the inositol concentration in the ileum and the inositol concentration in the blood. So it enters the metabolic system of the bird. Okay, so I think I can summarize and conclude now in regard to flexibility of these processes, this flexibility in regard to phytate management of the bird is extremely high. Phytate interacts with the epithelial layer in different ways that I have shown you. And to me, the fantastic thing that I learned from all this work was that it is clear now that the biological potential of the broiler for in-species degradation is very high. And from the biological background, there is good reasons that this is high. And endogenous phytases and other phosphatases are produced probably both by the mucosa and by the intestinal microbiota, and we still need to work on further differentiating that. But I showed you that we have different microbial communities in the lumen and in the mucosa, and it's probably necessary to more focus on what happens in the mucosal layer. But I also showed you that phosphorus and calcium supplements strongly reduce the biological potential that the bird has. Thank you.
Thank you, Marcus. So you have hello questions now. So we're right on time. One question. Pick one of them, Marcus.
Oh, here are my questions.
Your questions.
I'll pick the first one because I can keep the answer short.
That's good.
It's a very interesting question. We don't know. At least I haven't seen any data on that. As I said, the awareness, at least among nutritionists, it may be different among immunologists and veterinarians and so on, but the awareness of nutritionists that we have to differentiate between mucosa and digesta, microbiota, is not yet fully developed. So we still need to do a lot of work on that. And by the way, I have forgotten to mention that, in my opinion, or that you should keep in mind, that all this fantastic microbiota work that came up in recent years because of improvement in technologies and so on still is at the very beginning. So don't expect that by doing just one microbiota analysis and attach that to your animal study, you can understand the world. So that is a very complicated story. Many active species are not at all identified, so it's difficult already to understand phylogeny completely. And what is almost completely understand is the function of this microbiota system. So we are just at the beginning of all this. I believe it's very important to continue that, but before we get to the point where we get a clue on what the relevance is, we need to collect many data and then try to see whether we have certain trends in these data and in this responsive of microbiota composition and microbiota functioning.
So thank you very much.
I'm sorry that was a bit longer.
No,
the answer than the question was, but
We will have chance to discuss all the questions during our workshop. So please join me in thanking Marcus.